You've heard of green bones. Now get ready for blue soup. We've all been there. You look in the back of your fridge at a forgotten Tupperware or takeout box with a faint smell coming from it that makes you pretty sure it's far past edible. Maybe it's even growing a healthy blanket of mold. Usually your next move would be to toss the whole thing in the trash. And that's exactly what Dr. Elinne Becket did when she discovered a long-lost tub of soup in her fridge. But not before taking to Twitter to say that this soup was bright blue in color. In the words of her microbiology collaborator, Sebastian Cocioba,
it's like, okay, that's pretty cool. And then I saw the picture and it wasn't blue. It was like blue, blue. It was like primary blue.
Naturally, the Twitter sphere encouraged Dr. Becket to glove up and dig the soup out of her trash to answer the resounding question, why is it blue? Foods generally get their color from compounds synthesized in their cells, like carotenoids, chlorophyll, or anthocyanins, or from organisms living on them, like the fungus penicillium in blue cheese. These can form a wide range of colors, but the blue we see in this soup isn't a type of blue we see a lot in nature, let alone in the food we eat. Even the fruit dubbed a blueberry, which gets its color from anthocyanins, is more purple than blue. So what exactly happened to the soup to make it turn into this? Initially, we might think that some kind of fungus or bacteria started growing that gave the soup this color. Or if you've seen our blue cabbage video, you might think the soup had anthocyanins in it, since they're a pH indicator and one of the few things found in food that can turn bright cyan in the presence of a base. It turns out the answer is more full of twists and turns than anyone expected. But I won't spoil it. I'll let you hear it right from the investigators themselves. Here's Dr. Elinne Becket and Sebastian Cocioba to talk about their journey to solving the blue soup mystery and the joys that scientists all across the internet found along the way. So, Dr. Becket, you had originally thrown out this biohazard soup. So what convinced you to pursue this further?
And Sebastian, what was it that got you interested?
Well, I've been chasing blue for a really long time. Like, flowers are kind of my forte, and blue flowers are fairly rare. So I have this obsession of trying to make a blue rose. When I saw the thread and she said the word blue, like on the initial tweet, immediately I'm like, wait, it's a microbe. I can work with microbes. They might be simpler than plants. I mean, I was dying to get my hands on that sample.
I was like, no, there's no way. Like, I already went in the trash once. There's absolutely no way I'm going back in this. And here comes Sebastian and Pedro, or like, Sebastian's like, sequence it. I'll pay for the sequencer myself. You have to sample. And then of course, Pedro's egging me on as well. So I just dunked a Q-tip in there and threw it just so I could be like, okay, fine, Sebastian, I'll send it to you. You could do whatever the heck you want.
I felt bad for like 5 seconds.
Bottom line, long answer to a question is I'm very susceptible to peer pressure. And it was just so hilarious. Like, it's just, you can't shy away from a tale like this. It's just, let's see this through.
So now you guys had some swabs of a blue substance. Without knowing exactly what the contaminant was, how did you handle it in a way that ensured your safety?
So the first thing was questions of what the blue could be. If it's a secretion, like it's if it's a small molecule, that could be a telltale sign if it's biosafety level 1 or if it's an actual human pathogen. Right? I was trying to balance the go, no go. And then diving into the literature, I found a paper on King's Agar A and B, two types of media that discern two types of pseudomonads, where one is Pseudomonas aeruginosa, which is a human pathogen, and then Pseudomonas fluorescens is a BSL-1. And one produces a fluorescent signal while the other one doesn't on respective media, right? So it's kind of like playing a slightly risky game of guess who.
So one early hypothesis was that the soup was blue due to some kind of pH-related change, such as from anthocyanins. But this was ruled out almost immediately because, as you said, none of the ingredients in the soup contained anthocyanins. So what was it exactly that clued you in that it was bacteria causing the soup to turn blue?
When you've been doing microbiology for as long as you have, like, you can see, we know textures, we know colors, we know like those types of things. And so it was pretty obvious that this was not just a culture, but a bacterial culture. It didn't have like the texture that fungi do, the color, the consistency, all of that. And I feel like if it was coming from certain ingredients, that it wouldn't have been as uniformly in the way that it was like kind of spread out.
So Sebastian and Dr. Becket started with the facts that we can see. First and foremost, the brilliant blue color of the soup. As our investigators mentioned, it's not just the unusual color that's interesting, but also that the color is pretty evenly spread throughout the soup and not localized to a single region or vegetable. So the contaminant must be something that could diffuse throughout. Second is the environment of the soup. While it was left alone for a significant amount of time, it was kept in a refrigerator, an environment specifically intended to reduce the growth of food contaminants. So whatever grew in it must have been resistant to cold temperatures. Based on all of this, Sebastian and Dr. Becket are confident they're dealing with a bacterial contaminant, which notably is not one of the common sources of blue in our food. So what do you do when you want to figure out what kind of bacteria are growing in your food? Well, if you study genomics, you sequence it. Genome sequencing is a method that lets us examine all of the genes of an organism by identifying every base in a string of DNA. This allows scientists to match it against a database of known DNA sequences. So the sequencing results would tell us exactly which organisms were swimming in the soup. But elucidating the bacteria's DNA isn't the only tool in the microbiologist's toolbox. Before receiving the sequencing results, Sebastian ran a few interesting experiments at his home lab, using a scientific reagent familiar to us all, mozzarella cheese.
I saw that there were some Italian papers showing that this blue shows up on cheese. In my fridge, in the food fridge, not the bio fridge, my mom bought some mozzarella balls. And I asked her, just like, are we doing anything with these? Can I use them for science? So I take it, I drain it out, I put it in a sterile jar, and I write science cheese, do not eat. And so that was my stock of sterile cheese that I was going to inoculate with isolates from the plate after I struck it out in hopes that they would turn blue. And luck would have it that the 24 well plates fit those cheeses perfectly. It was like the most aesthetically confined cheese experiment.
In addition to the science cheese, both Sebastian and Dr. Becket used a variety of other methods to examine the properties of the soup contaminant. For example, you might have heard of a petri dish before. This is a plate that gets filled with some kind of growth medium, commonly a seaweed-based gel called agar, as well as nutrients that help bacteria grow into colonies for scientists to study. But we can also add more things to the medium that help identify bacteria based on specific characteristics. Sebastian used two types of media in his plates, King Agar A and B. King Agar A enhances the production of the blue pigment molecule pyocyanin, and King Agar B increases the production of a fluorescent molecule called fluorescein. One of Sebastian's plate streaking experiments suggested that a main contaminant of the soup was a strain of Pseudomonas bacteria, based on its fluorescence and iridescent appearance under a microscope. But this was probably just one of many contaminants, making them uncertain which one was responsible for the blue color. When early sequencing results came in from collaborating company Seacoast, the pieces started coming together.
So they put it through their pipeline and they were like, there's a really clear bin of Serratia cunivorans, and inside of that there is indigoidine, and based off of the percent representations and whatnot, this is like your most likely culprit.
The results identified bacterial genes that produce the compound indigoidine, a natural product that acts as, like its name suggests, a blue-colored dye. The next step was to figure out where exactly this dye was coming from and how so much of it ended up in the soup. Sebastian had a curious idea about this.
So Sebastian, you proposed a really interesting hypothesis partway through, that one contaminating microbe was secreting something that was taken up by another. According to the sequencing, it looked like the blue culprit was indigoidine secreted by Serratia cunivorans. Were you correct in this early hypothesis?
A really interesting experiment is called a T-streak, super simple, where you have one microbe struck this way and then another microbe crossing into it. So you have this gradient of growth across the exudates. So we have the producer as the bar of the T, and then we have the potential culprits of absorption vertically. And so if you see a gradient of absorption on one of the culprits but not on the others, then we have a pretty high likelihood that's the microbe that's taking up what's being secreted. Because I saw the blue first on the plates, and then only a couple of the colonies were starting to turn very, very dark blue. So I still strongly suspect that there's a producer and then an uptake one of it. But that's still up in the air, and we have to prove that. But there's like systematic ways in which we can do that that's not necessarily going to break the bank. Mm-hmm.
There was mounting evidence to support this hunch, including sequencing results that showed the blue-producing genes were very similar to those in S. cunivorans. But this still was not enough to be 100% certain. One way to be absolutely sure of what was causing the blue color? Isolate it. That is, pick out bacterial colonies that secreted the blue substance and grow more of those to study further. Dr. Becket and Sebastian had, at this point, a basic idea of what contaminants were in the soup, and a lead on why it was blue. After isolating the bacterial strain responsible, they could sequence the isolated bacteria and run analysis on the secreted blue substance. It turned out that the isolate was not, in fact, S. cunivorans, but rather another bacterium from the genus Pseudomonas, which is the bacteria type earlier analysis found to be most common in the soup. But Pseudomonads are not known for making indigoidine. They produce pyocyanin, a different blue compound that wasn't supported by earlier sequencing experiments. So then, how did Dr. Becket's soup turn blue? Well, like many questions in science, that mystery remains unsolved, for now. Update, not anymore. Since this video was filmed, Dr. Becket and Sebastian have made a lot of progress. After isolating the Pseudomonas strain they suspected was producing the soup's strange color, Dr. Becket collected a brand new soup sample to try and replicate that bacterial blue. Remaking the soup using her mom's secret recipe, Dr. Becket added the isolated bacteria and let it grow. It ended up taking on a blue hue just like the back of the fridge soup samples from the previous year. In the end, the culprit was a type of Pseudomonas bacteria, specifically the species Pseudomonas carnis, a common food contaminant that can secrete a blue compound. Usually, these bacteria secrete pyocyanin, but Dr. Becket's sequencing experiments didn't find evidence of the genes that make pyocyanin. Instead, they found evidence of other blue dyes, indigo and plastocyanin. So, if we know what the bacteria is, why all this confusion about what the compound is? It's possible that the blue-producing genes differed from the usual pyocyanin genes, making the soup contaminant a distinct bacterial strain. So, while we do have some clues, the actual identity of the compound, this blue dye, is still up in the air. Dr. Becket and Sebastian plan to name the bacterial strain in honor of the broth biome that brought about its discovery, immortalizing the blue soup saga in science. That said, there's always more to discover, and our intrepid investigators will be doing just that, and writing up the results for the whole world to see.
But getting to the bottom of this is definitely in the researchers' future plans.
So all of this is very cool, but we want to know what's next. So what future experiments are you guys planning to do, and are you going to publish to bioarchive?
I mean, we just started talking about starting a draft. If you have a working draft of what you have, then it's easy to like add on to that, you know, to at least have all the methods, like the results we have so far, to kind of put it together and kind of start to form it into a story. Because that also really helps to inform like what should be our immediate next steps. And it also gives you a little bit of an impetus to, okay, let's wrap this up, right? But no, for sure, bioarchive, preprint, we are staunchly proponents of open science and open access and everything. So all, of course, all genomic data, all any methods that we have in full protocol detail will be openly available to everyone.
So a lot of different methods in biology were integral to the success of this project. How transferable do you guys feel that your skills in plant biology and genomics were to this project?
I mean, we definitely used our respective skills in our research. I mean, Sebastian did mention like branching out to different specific assays, but the fundamental approaches that we used have been similar. And so for me, I focus mostly on the genomic side of things, being able to just have those libraries prepped and ready to go.
I mean, the blue soup thing was basically a skill check for me. Because everything that I've done in terms of environmental sampling and trying to get to know my surroundings translated into doing systematic bacteriology, essentially, like babies' systematic bacteriology with the blue soup stuff. So it was actually the things I've done prior informed me and prepared me for this particular thing. And then going forward, if this blue is prokaryotic blue, all my background in plant bioengineering is going to help me potentially turn this into a tool for plant biology. So even though they're two disparate things, like microbiology and plant biology are kind of distant, but there's so many relations.
Although the focus of this video is the blue soup mystery, Sebastian, I still wanted to ask you about your home lab. What was it that inspired you to pursue, as you call it, DIY bio?
Basically, every cent I make funnels into my nonprofit, Binomical Labs, where money goes to die. Our main focus is to like produce the software, hardware, wetware, and thoughtware necessary for anybody and everyone to do publishable research. We really want to make amateur biology like have rigor attached to it.
So one of the great things about the Blue Soup Saga is that it was seen by people from all over the world, all kinds of people that might be interested in science and interested in doing the kinds of things that you guys do. What advice do you have to people who might want to pursue a path similar to yours in science?
Okay, so my path is extremely non-traditional, and a lot of it was hard work and dedication for sure, but also the right place, right time, and the kindness of others, like tremendously. People believing in me was every time I hit a plateau in my own career, it was always a person that believed in me that opened the door. I'm an open book when I do my work. I hold no secrets. And because of that, people come up to me and just like, hey, I see that you do this thing. Could you help me with this thing? And I say, absolutely. It's an opportunity to do this thing. One of my like life mission things is to try to figure out how can you go from I'm curious about the living world to applying rigor towards science, even though it's not your career. Like you don't have to have a career in the sciences to be a scientist. I can't give career advice. My uncareer is super, super unconventional, and there's really no path. I'm still in the brambles with the machete going, I don't know where I am. And the trail I left behind is like weird and risky and on so many levels, right? And it takes a lot of sacrifice because I do this out of pocket. And I'll flip the burgers, I'll move the boxes. I don't care what it is, as long as I can do science at night. Now is the best time to dive in. If you're an amateur, if you want to do this as a hobby or pursue a degree. I mean, like, if you really want to go into sciences, there's so many programs that are wonderful, right? It doesn't have to be some Ivy League thing. Like I went to a community college, LaGuardia Community College, and I took a couple courses there. And that organic chemistry course that I took there was like 7 students. And it was the greatest science course I've ever had in my entire life.
And what about you, Dr. Becket?
I do also have a convention. I have like a way more conventional versus Sebastian, but still unconventional compared to the average academic or average professor, I would say. So I did the grad school postdoc, like typical path at research universities. And then, so my grad school lab was very, like my PI had already, I mentioned like Jeffrey Miller, everybody had like made his bones and stuff, you know, and he just wanted to dedicate the rest of his career to mentoring undergrads. And so in the lab that I was in, there was 12 undergrads at a time, and I was mentoring 4 of them as a grad student. And that was one of the happiest times. I'm like one of those, I know, that actually enjoyed grad school like very much, because I was lucky. I was so lucky to have a mentor who believed in me, and so what was Sebastian mentioned, and who had my back. And that was the key thing. And just like Sebastian, you can't give like career advice for stuff like this, because the stars just have to align in right place, right time, right people, and the people that you meet along the way, because network is so, so important when it comes to these things. If someone is interested in going into a PUI, specifically a primarily undergraduate institution, I have like a whole thread on it on Twitter about what it's like. But so it's kind of like 50-50 teaching. Well, it's more like 60-40, 75-25 teaching research. You do have a significant course load of teaching, but you do, as a tenure track faculty, you do also get to run your own research lab, and you get to mentor undergraduates, and you do have a lot of freedom when it comes to what you can study. I mean, there's still to be able to fund your research, go after grants, but there's a lot of opportunities for smaller ones that can sustain undergraduate level research that are much more accessible, that the pressure is not as much as it is at in a research one institution when it comes to going after that. And so the teaching load is a lot, but it's also very rewarding for those who like that.
As the Bluesoup saga has taught us, science is a web of mysteries that we pick apart piece by piece. Calling on our curiosity to solve these puzzles is what brings us together, professional and community scientists alike. If you want to see how the solving of the Bluesoup mystery played out in real time, check out the hashtag Bluesoup on Twitter, and the link's in the description. And if you want more science stories, well, that's elementary, my dear viewer. Just hit subscribe.